worship. Good morning, Central Church. It is a good and glorious day to be in worship together. This is Palm Sunday, the beginning of Holy Week, a day to celebrate for a while, a day to be in worship together to give glory to God. I'm Michelle Bogue-Trost. I'm the lead pastor here at Central, and it is a good thing to welcome you, whether you are here in this room or joining us via the live stream on YouTube or on participating by watching on cable TV later in this week. Wherever we are, wherever we have gathered, it is good to be together. If you are in the room, I invite you to find the brown pad toward the center aisle and fill that out with your contact information. We are still observing some precautions because COVID is still out there, flu is still out there, RSV is still out there, and we'd like to be able to contact people who are sitting near you if you develop one of those ugly things this week, which I hope you don't. But if you could complete that legibly and tear out the sheet and leave it on top of that when you're done, that would be great. If this is your first time at Central, I'm so glad to welcome you and to offer you our hope that this time together will be a meaningful experience. Whether you are in the room or you found us online somewhere, this is a congregation that works hard to welcome everyone, no matter who you are, where you come from, where you're going, who you love, as we love and serve God and our neighbor together. It is good to be together. May the Holy Spirit fill this time together, fill this space, fill your space, fill our hearts, that we may sing and pray and be joyful this morning. You will see that the order of worship is a little bit different this morning as we celebrate later on in the service. We will move to a service of lessons and hymns, moving through this week's worth of scriptures today. You will receive palms during our first hymn this morning. So, that all said, welcome to worship.
Good morning. I am Diana Gilday, and I'm serving as your liturgist today. We have David Brunton will be reading scripture today, and we have lots of musical moments with Sean and Roger and the chancel choir, and yes, I didn't forget anybody. We have the ushers and the tech team making it all happen, the tech team in the back, the ushers. If you have any concerns during the service, just raise your hand and they'll assist you in whatever way they possibly can. We have people watching the live chat on YouTube. Welcome to all of you. And so do remember that anything you post on the live chat will be public, and you do need to be logged in order to comment. We are gathered to worship together in many rooms and spaces. We celebrate God's presence with us wherever we are, and the opportunity this week to enter into the last week of Jesus' life. We begin our worship with the story of this day from Mark's Gospel, chapter 11, verses 1 through 11. When they were nearing Jerusalem, at Bethpage and Bethany on Mount Olives, he sent off two of the disciples with instructions. Go to the village across from you. As soon as you enter, you'll find a colt tethered, one that has never yet been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone asks, what are you doing? Say, the master needs him and will return him right away. They went and found a colt tied to a door at the street corner and untied it. Some of those standing there said, what are you doing untying that colt? The disciples replied exactly as Jesus had instructed them, and the people let them alone. They brought the colt to Jesus, spread their coats on it, and he mounted. The people gave him a wonderful welcome, some throwing their coats on the street, others spreading out rushes they had cut in the fields. Running ahead and following after, they were crying out, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in God's name. Blessed the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven. He entered Jerusalem, then entered the temple. He looked around, taking it all in. But by now it was late, so he went back to Bethany with the 12. And then we pray. Which prayer?
So let us pray together.
Thank you.
Holy One, As we celebrate the triumphant entry of Jesus into Jerusalem, we raise our voices and our palms across the millennia in honor of our King, shouting, Hosanna, with the exuberant hope of salvation. May our worship be filled with songs of praise and thanksgiving. And as we wave our branches high, let the spirit of gratitude fill our hearts. We ask it through Christ our Lord. Amen. Should we stand as we're willing and able and comfortable to sing our first hymn, number 278 in the red book, but also on the screens?
Thank you.
Holy and living God, we celebrate your presence. We celebrate by remembering a parade in Jerusalem with palm branches and confetti. We celebrate your visible presence in the world. The ways we experience you in our everyday. The spectacular ways that we notice your work. But we are here at the beginning of this holy week asking you to open us up to the rest of the story. To the story of parades and acclamation and hosannas, but also to the story of betrayal and pain and suffering and death. Because your message is not always comfortable. Your truth is not always peaceful to those who hear it. Open us up to the reality and the fullness of that truth. Help us to be participants in your good news, whether it's received as good by all or received poorly. You have called us to be your people in gladness and in sorrow, in good times and in bad. And so we ask that you strengthen us and encourage us and hold us as we walk through this week together. We pray for others. That is where our work of discipleship begins. We've mentioned names already, so many names, but there are so many more we keep with us, our family and friends, those close to us, whose names aren't on any list anywhere but are written in our hearts. You know each one, you know their needs, but here in this time and this place, we lift them to you as we speak their names aloud. Lord, in your love, hear our prayers, for we ask each one in the name of the one who comes, who rides into our lives and teaches us peace, the one who teaches us always to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Before we begin our lessons and hymns portion of the service, I sailed right through an announcement time, and I just want to call your attention to a couple of things. You can read them in the bulletin. If you are joining us online, our bulletin is on our website, on the front page of our website. The QR code should come up pretty soon, and you can scan that for all the information. But I just want to remind you that during Holy Week, we have a service on Maundy Thursday, this coming Thursday, at 7 o'clock. That's with communion. And Friday at 7 o'clock as well, we'll have a Good Friday service. Easter will be our regular service hours of 8:30 and 11 with the adult faith formation in between. There will be no Zoom tonight for the Chosen, for those who are watching the Chosen. We're not having that Zoom tonight. And the rest, I think you can find in the bulletin yourselves. But I just wanted to remind you that there is much more happening this week than normal because this is such a huge week in the Christian year. So just note that. We hear about the rest of the week in these coming scriptures. In this time of listening and singing, this time of letting the story tell itself, this is a powerful story. It is part of our identity because Palm Sunday isn't it. Easter isn't it. There's a whole bunch in between. Life and sorrow and pain and suffering. And we have to be able to sit with that as well to understand the depth and the power of the resurrection. So I've listened for 27 years now to the words of my seminary professor that said, there's no preaching you can do to top this story. Don't try to elaborate. It tells itself. And so with Diana and David and myself, we'll tell the story. And in between, we'll be singing verses of hymns. They will be on the screen. No need to stand. Just stay seated and just let these scriptures fill you up and let the hymns surround you.
Thank you. On the Mark 14:12-25, on the first of the days of unleavened bread, the day they prepare the Passover sacrifice, his disciples asked him, "Where do you want us to go and make preparations so you can eat the Passover meal?" He directed two of his disciples, "Go into the city. A man carrying a water jug will meet you. Follow him. Ask the owner of whichever house he enters, 'The teacher wants to know, where is my guest room where I can eat the Passover meal with my disciples?' He will show you a spacious second-story room, swept and ready. Prepare for us there." The disciples left, came to the city, found everything just as he had told them, and prepared the Passover meal. After sunset, he came with the 12. As they were at the supper table eating, Jesus said, "I have something hard but important to say. One of you is going to hand me over to the conspirators, one who is at this moment eating with me." Stunned, they started asking one after the other, "It isn't me, is it?" He said, "It's one of the 12, one who eats with me out of the same bowl. In one sense, it turns out that the Son of Man is entering into a way of treachery well marked by the scriptures. No surprises here. In another sense, the man who turns him in turns traitor to the Son of Man. Better never to have been born than do this." In the course of their meal, having taken and blessed the bread, he broke it and gave it to them. Then he said, "Take, this is my body." Taking the cup, he gave it to them, thanking God, and they all drank from it. He said, "This is my blood, God's new covenant poured out for many people. I'll not be drinking wine again until the new day when I drink it in the kingdom of God."
Thank you. Mark 14, verses 26 through 42. They sang a hymn and then went directly to the Mount of Olives. Jesus told them, "You're all going to feel that your world is falling apart and that it's my fault. There's a scripture that says, 'I will strike the shepherd. The sheep will go helter-skelter. But after I am raised up, I will go ahead of you, leading the way to Galilee.'" Peter blurted out, "Even if everyone else is ashamed of you when things fall to pieces, I won't be." Jesus said, "Don't be so sure. Tonight, this very night, in fact, before the rooster crows twice, you will deny me three times." He blustered in protest, "Even if I have to die with you, I will never deny you." All the others said the same thing. They came to an area called Gethsemane. Jesus told his disciples, "Sit here while I pray." He took Peter, James, and John with him. He plunged into a sinkhole of dreadful agony. He told them, "I feel bad enough right now to die. Stay here and keep vigil with me." "Go a little ahead." He fell to the ground and prayed for a way out. "Papa, Father, you can, can't you, get me out of this? Take this cup from me, but please, not what I want, what you want." He came back and found them sound asleep. He said to Peter, "Simon, you went to sleep on me? Can't you stick it out with me a single hour? Stay alert, be in prayer, so you don't enter the danger zone without even knowing it? Don't be naive. Part of you is eager, ready for anything in God, but another part is as lazy as a dog sleeping by the fire." He then went back and prayed the same prayer. Returning, he again found them asleep. They simply couldn't keep their eyes open, and they didn't have a plausible excuse. He came back a third time and said, "Are you going to sleep all night? No, you've slept long enough. Time's up. The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let's get going. My betrayer has arrived."
No sooner were the words out of his mouth when Judas, the one out of the 12, showed up, and with him a bunch of thugs, sent by the high priests, religion scholars, and leaders, brandishing swords and clubs. The betrayer had worked out a signal with them. "The one I kissed, that's the one. Seize him. Make sure he doesn't get away." He went straight to Jesus and said, "Rabbi," and kissed him. The others then grabbed him and roughed him up. One of the men standing there unsheathed his sword, swung, and came down on the chief priest's servant, cutting off the man's ear. Jesus said to them, "What is this, coming after me with swords and clubs as if I were a dangerous criminal? Day after day I've been sitting in the temple teaching, and you never so much as lifted a hand against me. What you, in fact, have done is confirm the prophetic writings." All the disciples ran.
They led Jesus to the chief priest, where the high priest, religious leaders, and scholars had gathered together. Peter followed at a safe distance until they got to the chief priest's courtyard, where he mingled with the servants and warmed himself at the fire. The high priest, conspiring with the Jewish council, looked high and low for evidence against Jesus by which they could sentence him to death. They found nothing. Plenty of people were willing to bring in false charges, but nothing added up, and they ended up canceling each other out. Then a few of them stood up and lied. "We heard him say, 'I am going to tear down this temple built by hard labor and in 3 days build another without lifting a hand.'" But even they couldn't agree exactly. In the middle of this, the chief priest stood up and asked Jesus, "What do you have to say to the accusation?" Jesus was silent. He said nothing. The chief priest tried again, this time asking, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed?" Jesus said, "Yes, I am, and you'll see it yourself. The Son of Man seated at the right hand of the Mighty One, arriving on the clouds of heaven." The chief priest lost his temper. Ripping his clothes, he yelled, "Did you hear that? After that, do we need witnesses? You heard the blasphemy. Are you going to stand for it?" They condemned him, one and all. The sentence, death. Some of them started spitting at him. They blindfolded his eyes, then hit him, saying, "Who hit you? Prophesy!" The guards, punching and slapping him, took him away. While all this was going on, Peter was down in the courtyard. One of the chief priest's servant girls came in and, seeing Peter warming himself there, looked hard at him and said, "You were with the Nazarene Jesus." He denied it. "I don't know what you're talking about." He went out on the porch. A rooster crowed. The girl spotted him and began telling the people around, "He's one of them." He denied it again. After a little while, the bystanders brought it up again. "You've got to be one of them. You've got Galilean written all over you." Now Peter got really nervous and swore, I never laid eyes on this man you're talking about." Just then, the rooster crowed a second time. Peter remembered how Jesus had said, "Before a rooster crows twice, you'll deny me three times." He collapsed in tears.
First light, the high priest with the religious leaders and scholars arranged a conference with the entire Jewish council. After tying Jesus securely, they took him out and presented him to Pilate. Pilate asked him, "Are you king of the Jews?" He answered, "If you say so." The high priest let loose a barrage of accusations. Pilate asked again, "Aren't you going to answer anything?" That's quite a list of accusations. Still, he said nothing. Pilate was impressed, really impressed. It was a custom at the feast to release a prisoner, anyone the people asked for. There was one prisoner called Barabbas, locked up with the insurrectionists who had committed murder during the uprising against Rome. As the crowd came up and began to present its petition for him to release a prisoner, Pilate anticipated them. "Do you want me to release the king of the Jews to you?" Pilate knew by this time that it was through sheer spite that the high priest had turned Jesus over to him. But the high priest by then had worked up the crowd to ask for the release of Barabbas. Pilate came back. "So what do I do with this man you call the king of the Jews?" They yelled, "Nail him to a cross." Pilate objected, "But for what crime?" Pilate gave the crowd what it wanted. "Set Barabbas free and turn Jesus over for a whipping and crucifixion." The soldiers took Jesus into the palace called Praetorium and called together the entire brigade. They dressed him up in purple and put a crown, plaited from a thorn bush, on his head. Then they began their mockery. "Bravo, King of the Jews." They banged on his head with a club, spit on him, and knelt down in mock worship. After they had their fun, they took off the purple cape and put his own clothes back on him. Then they marched out to nail him to the cross. There was a man walking by, coming from work, Simon from Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. They made him carry Jesus' cross. The soldiers brought Jesus to Golgotha, meaning Skull Hill. They'd offered him a mild painkiller, wine mixed with myrrh, but he wouldn't take it. And they nailed him to the cross. They divided up his clothes and threw dice to see who would get them.
They nailed him up at 9 o'clock in the morning. The charge against him, the king of the Jews, was scrawled across a sign. Along with him, they crucified two criminals, one to his right, the other to his left. People passing along the road jeered, shaking their heads in mock lament. "You bragged that you could tear down the temple and then rebuild it in 3 days, so show us your stuff. Save yourself. If you're really God's son, come down from that cross." The high priests, along with the religion scholars, were right there mixing it up with the rest of them, having a great time poking fun at him. He saved others, but he can't save himself. Messiah, is he? King of Israel? Then let him climb down from that cross. We'll all become believers then. Even the men crucified alongside him joined in the mockery. At noon, the sky became extremely dark, and the darkness lasted 3 hours. At 3 o'clock, Jesus groaned out of the depths, crying loudly, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you abandoned me?" Some of the bystanders who heard him said, "Listen, he's calling for Elijah." Someone ran off, soaked a sponge in sour wine, and put it on a stick and gave it to him to drink, saying, "Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down." But Jesus, with a loud cry, gave his last breath. At that moment, the temple curtain ripped right down the middle. When the Roman captain standing guard in front of him saw that he had quit breathing, he said, "This has to be the Son of God." There were women watching from a distance, among them Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of the younger James and Joseph, and Salome. When Jesus was in Galilee, these women followed and served him and had come up with him to Jerusalem. Late in the afternoon, since it was the day of preparation, that is, the eve of the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a highly respected member of the Jewish council, came. He was one who lived expectantly on the lookout for the kingdom of God. Working up his courage, he went to Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. Pilate questioned whether he could be dead that soon and called for the captain to verify that he was really dead. Assured by the captain, he gave Joseph the body. Having already purchased a linen shroud, Joseph took him down and wrapped him in the shroud, placed him in a tomb that had been cut into the rock, and rolled a large stone across the opening. Mary Magdalene and Mary, mother of Joseph, watched the burial.
Thank you.
Shall we pray together? Holy One, who rides into our cities, who draws near to our lives, we too rise to greet you, to shout our hosannas, for you are a great God, a loving friend, a wise counselor. But deep in our being, we fear your arrival. You offer us a choice, and to choose you means letting go of all that keeps us from you. Like the people of Jerusalem, we discover that you are more than we first thought. Beyond loud hosannas, you ask for our lives, and we are learning piece by piece to give them to you. This day, this week, move us into the deepest levels of ourselves. Open us to the entire story of your life with us. Guide us from the woundedness of this world to the hope that is Easter. Amen. We'll sing to close worship. It's number 2111 in the black book. And we're just going to sing verses 1 and 4. Just 1 and 4. And I invite you to stand as you're comfortable or willing to sing together. As you go into this holy week, may you ask the same questions. May you open yourselves to God's answer. May you go in the peace of Christ. Amen.